be weary. Them young girls, they do get weary.
It is an epic story. That which gave it life nearly killed it more than once. Innocence, naked innocence, good and evil, light and dark, black and white. In Memphis in the 60s, people who couldn't dine together joined together to make music, soul music, at a place called Stax.
We're rolling. Take one.
It was a happening, a cosmic happening. The door opened, the wind blew in, and we were smart enough not to fight it.
We were doing the kind of music that was unheard of.
Raw, gritty, gutsy soul.
We lived every day as though this was the last day we're gonna get to do this.
We knew we had something, we just didn't know what.
God almighty, how many hits did we cut?
Stax had the funk. Stax had the funk.
It didn't matter about the color of your skin. We weren't in there doing things to prove that we were black and they were trying to prove they were white. We were in there proving that music is a sentiment of a man's soul.
You had segregation in the city of Memphis, but you could come into the doors of Stax Records where you had freedom, harmony, people working together and not making a difference between black and white.
After Dr. King was assassinated, things began to deteriorate.
When we're reduced to our irreducible essence, naked against the world, we're still somebody.
So much blood, sweat, and tears went into that company from so many of us.
You got an environment where there's camaraderie, spirit of love, and then you're gonna let some people now come, guns strapped on their sides, and push people around.
There was a hole in the boat that would have sunk the boat without outside influences.
Truth crushed to the earth shall rise again.
Once you're part of the music, it's till you die.
Stax.
Stax.
Stax Records.
Stax.
Stax Records.
Jim Stewart was a banker by day and a country fiddle player at night. His sister Estelle was a former school teacher whose main exposure to music was through her teenage son. In 1960, they pooled their money to rent an old movie theater in a black Memphis neighborhood, hoping to record country songs.
I can tell my milk cow, I can tell by the way she lows. If you see my milk cow, please drive.
Stax Records was an accident. Jim Stewart moved into the theater, and nature threw him a curve. And a flower garden started to grow, composed of many different colors, and they all came in.
Get out your little prayer book. Get out on your knees and pray.
My sister mortgaged her house to set up the recording studio there at that building, which was on Macklemore. Word got around in the neighborhood, and we started getting people coming in, musicians, singers, whatever. They would come to the studio, and we would listen to them, talk with them.
In this world, I'm gone.
Robert Talley came by my house and told us that there's a new recording studio over there on Macklemore College.
He said, you want to go? And I said, yeah, let's go see what it's like. And that, it was just that simple.
the Flowers began to play their music and to demonstrate their creativity, Jim said, I can get into this. And Estelle said, welcome.
That's the part I played on the baritone sax. I told them that day that I could also play the piano.
He was just a kid, about 15 or 16 years old. We needed a baritone saxophone. He said, I can play the baritone. I knew he could play guitar and trombone and all of this. So we gave him the baritone sax. He had that one line, dum ding dum ding dum 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 dum, yuck a dum dum dum.
Come on, come on. At that time, really, I thought nothing about white folk. I think that all white folk are the same. I'm trying to get my talent out there, and they were the ones who could give me that chance to expose my talent. I shared it, that black-white thing at Stax.
We never looked at color. We looked at people and their talent.
What Stax was doing right there in Memphis, which is right there at the crossroads of the South and the North and black and white and the blues and the funk, was really the axis by which everything turned.
Now, if you can imagine, nobody's ever heard R&B music before. White kids had never heard it. And you can imagine what that did to us. It was like, you know, going to another planet, a real good planet, you know.
The band that I had out of high school, all we wanted to play was rhythm and blues. This guy come up to me that I didn't have any classes with, so I didn't really know who he was. He introduced himself, and he says, hey, man, I hear you guys have a good band. He said, I'd like to be in your band. And I said, well, we're not looking for anybody. What do you do? And he said, I play saxophone. I said, how long have you been playing? He said, oh, man, I've been taking lessons for 3 months. But somewhere in that conversation, he told me his uncle had a recording studio, which actually turned out to be a couple of microphones and and a machine in a garage. But hey, in those days, it was a recording studio.
Everybody in that band loves the same music. In the Marquees, everybody in that band loved black guys' music. Here's a bunch of white guys trying to do a bunch of black guys' music. But we started getting some attention, and we started getting some notoriety.
The first time I walked into a recording studio, I cut a number one record, and that was Last Night. You hear fresh people having a great time, and they got invited to a party they didn't even know existed, and they were paying us, and we just couldn't get over how much fun we were having. Poor old Jim, it was life and death to him. You know, he had to sell records and get that groove, man.
Ms. Axton thought Last Night was a hit record, nobody else did, and they didn't want to put it out. So she got her way about it. And I mean, within 3 weeks, it was through the roof.
Atlantic Records out of New York heard about 'Cause I Love You. And they purchased the master, and from there, it just sort of mushroomed.
Maybe it was some chord changes, maybe it was a lick, maybe it was a song. But they started playing, they started building it. I said, my God, this is fantastic. And I made a distribution arrangement for it.
came down here and was listening to the radio and then turned on TV, it was like turning back the hands of time 15 or 20 years from what I was accustomed to in New York. People down here were living like in this little sheltered world, and they were growing up in an era that had already gone by.
Now I sit and wonder, said, how can this be?
I couldn't conceive of what would be here. I couldn't imagine. But when I pulled up in front of a theater with a record store in what used to be the lobby, I thought, well, this has got to be something else, you know? And it was.
Estelle Axton had turned the theater's concession stand into the satellite record shop, welcoming anyone who wanted to buy something or just listen. Her store soon became the neighborhood hangout.
During the summertime, she would put a little speaker thing out there on the door so you could hear it. And we would dance out on the sidewalk.
Before that, I had to drive 20 minutes out to Sears to look at records, you know, and all the records out there were only country records.
Mrs. Axton had a pulse on the creativity. She knew what the dance beats were. She knew what sounds were popular back then.
She wasn't involved in the production in terms of being in the studio, but all of her influence went on in the record shop. Hey, you guys need to listen to this. This is the hot new dance. This is the hot beat. This is the kind of song they're going for.
That's how you learn in the music business. You talk to that person that's buying that product, and that makes you know what to make.
You don't miss your water till your well runs dry.
But I came to Memphis, everything in Memphis was segregated. There was not one thing integrated. Nothing. From the cradle to the grave was segregated in Memphis, Tennessee, 1959, when I moved here. And I never really understood why the graveyards had to be segregated, because dead people get along well. They don't bother nobody.
I found my solace, if you will, when we could go inside of Stax, and, you know, and those doors closed, and not be a part of that.
At 926 East Macklemore, forget skin tone. The only tone that mattered came out of your instrument. Two white marquees and two black neighborhood musicians became the greatest recording unit in soul music, Booker T and the MGs.
The one unit which recorded all, just about all of the Stax product, Steve and Duck and Booker T and Al Jackson.
I knew Cropper because he was the clerk at Satellite and waited while I listened to tons of records, you know, for hours.
I wound up doing odd jobs like marking tapes and sweeping the floor, cleaning the piano, and doing whatever I could do.
Every now and then, I would hear music come from behind the curtain. I knew there was a theater back there. I didn't know there was a recording studio. But... the blues that we were playing that we thought would make a record that would sell for us. And that was the one that we were excited about.
Jim said, if we decide to put this out, have you got anything you can put on a B-side? So I happen to remember a riff that Booker played me a week or two prior to that session. It was a pretty good riff.
I went through the front doors of the theater into the Stax Studios and around to Studio A and opened the door. And I witnessed something that I had never experienced before, that these two black guys and these two white guys were playing music together. I was awestruck.
Booker's the musician in the group, always has been. Duck and I, we know how to pat our foot, we know how to dance. We can keep the groove going. And Booker can do that too, but he's the musician in the group, always has been.
And Booker looking at me sometimes like, you don't know that?
Yeah, it's... It wasn't about the notes of the music or the melody of the song. It was about the groove. And if you could adapt that song, whatever it was, and get it with Al Jackson, he put it in a pocket. That's when the song started to happen. That's when we said, okay, that's a take, guys. Next song.
I think our family grew just from us being in the studio, and it just grew over the years of us spending time in the studio and eating lunch together, eating dinner, and it became a family that grew around the music.
When a band arrived from Georgia in the fall of 1962, no one could have known that Stax's biggest star would walk in carrying the gear for someone else's session.
That's Star Wars.
I remember them pulling up, Johnny Jenkins and the Pine Toppers is who they were.
Here, this big, tall guy gets out of the driver's seat, and gets the keys, goes around to the trunk. He starts pulling amplifiers and microphones and guitars out of the trunk. It's like he was setting up for a gig, you know? During a session, we were having a little playback break, and Al Jackson says, you know, he said, the guy that was driving Johnny, he said, well, he's been bugging me to death. He wanted me to hear him sing. And he said, would you take some time and get this guy off of my back and listen to him?
Everybody was tired, and a couple of musicians had already left. So it's like, well, we got to do this. The guy's been sitting here waiting all day. Let's see what he sounds like.
So he played him church chords, he called him. And we started playing, and he started singing These Arms of Mine. And I know my hair lifted out about 3 inches, and I couldn't believe this guy's voice.
These arms of mine, they are lonely, lonely and feeling blue. These arms of mine.
That moment,
the Otis Redding
singing that song. When you're in a moment like that, you're not thinking that it's going to sell a lot of records. You're thinking, you're it's all heart. It's all heart and experiencing the moment. It's, time gets frozen there when you're involved in something like that.
They started working up These Arms of Mine, and everybody, secretaries, people came out of the record shop. Everybody got up and came and was looking inside. And when he finished it, they had another artist.
Otis became that power pack, raw, gutsy, emotional, serious performer. I mean, you felt him, you heard the tear in his voice, and that captivated me. And I must tell you, when I went on the radio to play records, it was Otis Redding and me. We were having an affair on the air.
He would come in the door with the whole song, the whole recording in his mind and be able to tell all of us what he wanted. He'd come over there and sing to us, da, 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 da. They'd get right in your face with his fist and do that to you.
He put a spark under Stax. I mean, there's no question about it. He never ran out of ideas.
Otis gonna help you get to a different place with Otis Redding, because Otis gonna come in and Otis gonna hum the horn parts, the bass parts, give you the parts, and then go up on the microphone and he's gonna start stumping pigeon toe and knocking it dead. I mean, he was just unbelievable.
These were like during the 60s, all of the Black Power movements, marches, and all of these things were coming along. Otis wrote Respect for that, and he put it in a sense of a love relationship, but it was about life, really.
R-E-S-P-E-C-T, now that's what it mean to me. R-E-S-P-E-C-T, take care of T-C-P.
I grew up in a neighborhood that was obviously segregated, and there was one man who had a fruit stand, and he raised pedigree bulldogs. And that's a place where I was able to go and make a little money cleaning up after those filthy bulldogs. He said, "Niggas can't do nothing but sing and dance." For some odd reason, I realized, wait a minute, singing and dancing, you make a lot of money. So that's not a problem. That's a positive. That's an opportunity.
After high school in Little Rock, Al Bell attended Southern Christian Leadership Conference workshops with Martin Luther King. But Bell's vision was economic empowerment. He became a top DJ on the East Coast before returning south to take a job at Stax.
We weren't a professional company before Al. We were operating, but we didn't have big business going on. We had big music going on, but we didn't know how to do it. Jim didn't know how to do it. Jim was a banker. Al Bell had a beard, and he was announcing blackness, which, you know, wasn't done very much then.
To sit in that office with this white man, sharing the same telephone, sharing the same thoughts, and being treated like an equal human being, was a breath of fresh air for me.
Al was very creative, but Al, of course, took more and more responsibility of not only the
promotion, but business.
He's beautiful. He can make anything. I mean, the bigger the numbers, the more Al liked it. If you said, Al, $1 billion, he probably would have gone, lit up, and shot out the roof like a rocket.
He said, I'm going to make a graph. I'm going to make a thermometer. And he says, at the end of the week sales, when I get the weekly report, he says, I'm going to color in the thermometer.
And at the very top of the thermometer, I had it where it would explode and out into what I called heaven. And that was after we had achieved 1 million.
So, man, we couldn't wait to come in there on Monday morning and see where that marker's going to be.
They'd come in and just see that thermometer just increasing, 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 increasing. And as it increased, the morale increased. People got more excited and all of that. And eventually, it exploded into heaven.
Stax never suspected that one of the greatest songwriting teams in history was developing at their doorstep. Isaac Hayes and David Porter, who would ride the highs and lows with Stax, were two neighborhood kids scraping by, hoping to make it in music.
Isaac lived with his grandmother. For some reason, he was an orphan, and sometimes he'd sleep over in the back seat of a car. And David, he sold insurance, and he sacked groceries across the street from Stax. I'm never a loser,
and I'm never a quitter, yeah. I was working at a grocery store, singing at clubs under the name of Little David at night, just trying to get in, selling life insurance, and had an old raggedy car, and he didn't have a car.
And we'd ride, we would ride down the street, and you could tell where we'd been because we'd leave a trail of foam from his seat cushion far out the bottom of his car. They'd see us with out-of-shape cases, and they would tease us, hey, hitmakers, how many hits y'all write today? But we just kept charging on, you know, relentlessly. Pack him up today. Here I come,
just a big bad man. When I walk away, baby. After years of not finding their own sound, Sam and Dave signed with Jerry Wexler at Atlantic, who sent them to the hinterland of Memphis to record at Stax. Sam and Dave were sure it was the end of their career.
The tears started streaming down my face. I looked at Dave and I said, oh my God, how could Atlantic do this to us?
Sam and Dave, the dynamic duo, and I'd also like to refer to Isaac and David as being the dynamic duo of writers. That's one of the greatest things that ever happened.
That was a chemistry, Sam and Dave, Hayes and Porter. That chemistry works.
And right behind the song, You Don't Know Like I Know, we knew we had found ourselves. And so that's when it changed for us. And we became extremely comfortable in our own skin to do hits on anybody. And we got cocky with it.
They'd send these masters up north, and I'd say, praise Jesus.
Stax Stax threw open its doors to capture the sound of the street. Feeling was all that mattered. Meanwhile, up north in Detroit, another label was packaging R&B for crossover appeal.
There was no comparison. You know, there was only one Joe Louis, only one Muhammad Ali, there's only one Motown.
Motown was like the company for me because Berry Gordy was doing what I wanted to see done in the marketplace with a record company in terms of how the company was perceived and accepted by the larger segment of society.
When we were cutting hit records, we had a factory with multiple amount of producers and writers. It had an assembly line type procedure.
But Stax and me had that funky stuff. That big bass thing that come out at you, reach out and grab you. That was the difference between Stax and Motown. Motown had the sweet, but Stax had the funk.
Otis Redding to get a shot at Motown, no. They did not have an open door policy at Motown Records. Never.
They took great pride in saying Hitsville, USA. And so in my mind, I thought something should be done to distinguish us from Motown, then people would have to look at us as, oh, this is the one that's different from Hitsville. This is Soulsville.
Andrew and I always said, what are we going to do when this is over? You know, this will end one day, maybe tomorrow, and we'll be just like we were when we started this. A couple of kids that didn't get an education but know how to play these horns. What are we going to do? We're going to have a bait shop or sell barbecue and 45s, what are we gonna do? When we got to 67, when we went to Europe, and we saw the reaction in the European crowd to what we were doing, we knew that we'd made a difference.
He was very excited about going to Europe. And he tried to get me to come along, but I was a wife and a mother. He called him home at least 4 or 5 times a day. He would say, I blew them away. And I'm like, okay, it's 4 o'clock in the morning.
We did a lot of halls where rhythm and blues music had not been. You know, they were concert halls, symphonic halls, and we were kind of anxious because we didn't know how people were going to accept it. We didn't know what kind of audience was coming, you know?
And the European people went crazy. They went crazy. And, wow, they like us, huh? You know, they like us.
If you want to be a road, got to do the thing with soul.
To be treated by the bellhops or attendants at the hotels in London like stars. We hadn't felt that or experienced that before. But Dr. King said, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, I'm free at last.
It changed everybody's perception of themselves, because none of us had ever been paid that much attention. That Stax Volt tour, it gave us a new insight to what the world really thought of us. Because we didn't think probably outside the block we lived on.
We just, you know, we would throw our coats off and spin and turn and singing and, oh, that was it. It was having church.
They had everybody just in pandemonium. I mean, they'd faint. One of them would just faint, fall out, come out, drag him off stage. And then Sam would say, good night. They would come back out and head start again.
I gotta tell you, when Sam and Dave finished, Otis Redding broke from behind that stage out and grabbed the microphone, and he started going from one end of the stage to the other end of the stage. I couldn't believe what was going on, and it was gata, 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 gata. I mean, just the energy that I had never seen before.
But it's all so easy. All you got to do is try.
Ended up playing the Monterey Pop Festival. That was the culmination of our European tour, and that was a life-changing experience for me.
With 50,000 people there, and they had all the hippie guys with the long hair and the torn blue jeans and the tennis shoes, and there we were in silk suits and beetle boots and sweaters alike doing steps. So we must have looked like a lounge act or something. I don't know what, but it killed them. And when Otis walked on stage, it was over for everybody.
This is the love crowd, right? We all love each other, don't we? Am I right? Let me hear you say yeah now. All right. have been loving you too long to stop now.
But we got so much attention when we were in Europe. And to be invited to do Monterey, we looked at each other and said, this is it.
And at that night, as Andrew and I tipped up a bottle of Jack Daniels in our hotel room, he said, I think we can make a living at this. And that was the day that we turned that corner, 27 years old.
And I don't want to stop now, no. Do that one more time out, just like that. Ow! Ow! Do it just one more time, one more. Ow! Ow! Do it just one more time. Ow! Ow! With you,
Otis was our standard bearer. I mean, he was the man. I mean, the world was beginning to view Stax as Otis Redding.
1967 was a meteoric year for Otis Redding. After Monterey, he was embracing a new life with the pop audience. 27 years old and at the peak of his creative abilities, he left in December with the Barqués on a weekend tour of the Midwest in his new plane.
I had spoke with him earlier that morning. He wanted to speak to the kids, and it was like, something is not right. Something, it was a feeling.
And I don't want to stop now. No, no, no. I've been loving you just a little bit too long.
We just happened to turn on the TV. And then they said, bulletin. Plane belonging to Otis Redding. I just put my hands in my ear. I didn't even hear the rest of it.
And he said, man, did you hear about Otis? They all went in the lake up in Wisconsin. I said, you mean they had a crash? He said, yes, and they're all gone.
I can remember the minister, because he was the minister that married us. It was just too much for my mind, for my body, too much sorrow.
I love you, baby. I love you, honey. Good God Almighty. Good God Almighty, I love
Stax lost their biggest star and the heart and soul of the label. Then, within weeks, they learned that the fine print of their distribution deal with Atlantic took from them ownership of everything they'd released. Suddenly, Stax found itself gutted. A record company with no records.
I had not read the fine print in the distribution agreement. And Jerry Wexler, that, you know, I love Jerry, you know, but we had a serious, serious argument.
It was sort of like, that's not what you said, and that's not what you implied. But then they go, well, yeah, but the paper says this. Well, there didn't need to be any paper in the first place.
As it turned out, Sam and Dave were not really signed to Stax as artists. They were signed to Atlantic and loaned out to Stax.
To this love of mine.
It was a family thing. That chemistry works. So when they broke that mold and took us back, it all went downhill after that.
So these were really Atlantic artists, and we are the little guys down in Memphis, Tennessee that really didn't get it, didn't know it.
In the face of all these hardships, the Stax family could still rely on each other. But in early 1968, something happened in Memphis that would banish Stax from its garden.
When you listen to the music that came out of Stax, you would think that Memphis was this sort of special oasis of intergroup love and affection and coexistence and that type of thing, but it was really just the...
I mean, I spent the last hour of his life on Earth. About a quarter to six, we stepped on that balcony. He stood here, I stood here. I got five steps. Kapow! The shot rang out. I looked back and saw he had been knocked from the railing back onto the balcony. I rushed to his side. There was a gaping hole in the right side of his face, and blood was everywhere, just bleeding profusely. I ran in the room to call an ambulance. You couldn't use the phone without the operator. When the operator heard the shot, she left the switchboard. Oh, wow. I'm beating on the wall saying, answer the phone, answer the phone, answer the phone. She went in the courtyard, looked up and saw Martin on the floor, and she had a heart attack on the spot.
Wow.
She died about 4 days later. I ran back outside, the police were coming. And I hollered to them, call an ambulance on your police radio, Dr. King has been shot. They said, where did the shot come from? So that's where the picture comes with us pointing.
Everything changed. It had to. Gone were their heroes, their stars, all the records they'd made. Yet among the ashes, an ember still burned.
They said Stax is dead. There will be no more Stax. From that moment to watch Stax, I was on the keel to take Stax and those artists to that level of appreciation in this country.
We had a lot of confidence, and so we were very adamant and determined that we were going to be successful.
Al Bell, when he came to Stax, he brought that large sack of BS with him. He could get on the telephone and make things happen, and he was great.
We were all young and naive, I guess, and certainly our love for what we were doing, even at that point, and for Stax Records, was unquestionable.
And Al Bell was like a rocket that was already launched and was orbiting, and nothing could stop him.
He dipped that phone in that BS, and everybody at the other end would, yeah, didn't like it.
It was during that period of time when the finger snap was developed. And the finger snap at that point in time, even though we had the records flipping up and down, you know, off the turntable, the finger snap signaled a change.
Stax was a company that had been betrayed and almost ruined, but the music, its soul, refused to die. Somewhere in the wreckage, a new vision began taking shape.
In the process, I started looking for whatever that sound could have been or would have been that was a merger between Stax and this raw, gritty, gutsy soul, and Motown in its contemporary, sophisticated, polished soul.
Who's Making Love was a step off the curb for all of us because it was such a sexually...
The idea was try to get as many hit records as we possibly can in the marketplace, and then do the impossible. Let us have a sales conference. Let us put together 28 albums, and I work that out on paper. Bring all of these distributors in and let them know that we are a formidable independent record company.
Everybody believes in everything LBL said. So we're going to record 28 albums. Yeah? When?
27 albums was high mercy.
We had a meeting. Everything was explained to us that we have got to rebuild the catalog.
And I was busy back and forth on the phone, pumping everybody up, and I mean, just driving.
Soul Explosion Venture, Al Bell's baby. Al Bell came up with this idea that he was gonna explode and flood the market with Stax material. One was a major success, and that was Hot Buttered Soul.
It's a beautiful thing to see Isaac go from background guy to sing with this unique and unusual record to becoming a superstar.
You gave me, you put the hurt on me, you socked it to me, mama, when you said goodbye.
I saw something in Isaac Hayes that I had not seen before. And that bald head, I mean, bald heads weren't popular back then, but Isaac Hayes had a bald head. And so from a marketing standpoint, we could probably do wonders with this guy.
When Al Bell told me he wanted me to help him on all these acts being recorded for the spring sales meeting, I said I wanted to do an album myself and do it the way I wanted to. Because I knew that they weren't relying on me to give them a hit album, because we had 26 other albums to pull them through. So I selfishly wanted to do this album.
So please walk right on by, baby. Oh, it's no dust in my eye, no, no. I don't want you to see me cry, no.
And it crossed over. It just started my whole career.
A rebirth was blossoming within the walls of Stax, but outside, in the streets of Soulsville, a darker reality was taking hold.
One day, two young black men came in Stax Records and went in Jim Stewart's office and laid a big piece of iron down on his desk, 357 Magnum, I guess, a big pistol, and said, if you don't give us $50,000 in the next 2 days, we're gonna kill you.
After Dr. King was killed, it got pretty intense around there.
We started experiencing some attitudes that were directed toward both the white side and the black side of our oasis.
Al Bell sent me to West Memphis, Arkansas. I bought 5 38 pistols. He said, anybody gives you any, pull the trigger.
The neighborhood had changed so bad they had to put up an 8-foot chain link fence with guards and so forth. Only, you know, you had to almost have a laminate to get in and out.
I was threatened by people outside the company, threatening to kidnap me, trying to extort money from me.
I went to the FBI. I got no help whatsoever. You're over there on Macklemore Avenue. What are you doing over there? And, you know, that kind of mentality. So we brought in Johnny Baylor, along with his sidekick, Dino.
Johnny Baylor had worked with Sugar Ray Robinson. A former Army Ranger, he was running a small record label in New York's Harlem.
Al knew that Johnny Baylor and Dino, these two guys, now they were toughs, New York tough street guys, and they were killers. I mean, they were people who did the thing.
We just challenged them and let them know that, hey, either do or die, you know? That's what it is. We're gonna protect these artists. We're gonna protect Al Bell, you know? And it will be no more of this robbery and stealing and stick-ups or whatever they were doing.
Now, after that, Jim was a little further out of control because he had two guys there. And Jim said, we'll let them be Isaac Hayes' security. He's just getting to where he's gonna need some security. And we'll let them be the head of Stax Security.
Johnny Baylor and Dino, at times, they were described as our protectors. And at sometimes they appeared to harass us.
I never will forget this, but Johnny Baylor had grabbed my arm and just twisted my arm behind me and had me pushed against the wall. And I gave him, like, really bad punch in a place I don't think he'll ever forget.
It was a conspiracy to take over the control of the most powerful individual, in his view, in the company at that particular time, which was Isaac. And if he felt he could do that, then he could call shots on about whatever he wanted to call.
And Johnny felt that Isaac should be out front of David Porter.
They put a gun up to David Porter's head once and told him to stay away from Isaac.
He really wanted to see Isaac out being number one, you know.
Well, there went all that songwriting. Those magical songs gone.
Johnny Baylor stayed around Stax. He was the problem solver who would soon become the problem.
That was the day that I went to Jim and told him we'd like to be off the payroll.
Estelle Axon, she got caught up in some of the politics of the company. As we got bigger and got bigger, I think she was made to be quieter and quieter and quieter.
I closed the record shop because they needed the space for the studio and offices for Stax. And so I was lost without.
He and my sister did not get along. It had gotten to the point that Al was ready to leave. Well, I had a decision to make, a very hard decision to make. It involved family, number one. In the end, I made the decision that more people's livelihood were at stake than just mine. And I made the decision to ask that my sister step down.
But I decided, well, I'll never have any influence in the future. The best thing for me to do is get out. And that's when I sold my part and got out.
Left, the magic was gone. You know, this building will never be the same. And it was never the same again.
Jim and Al were now equal partners in a company that was outgrowing its mom and pop roots New demands meant that old ways had to change.
There was a feeling like mass production or assembly line type feeling. Actually, at one point, they had us operating in shifts, 3 8-hour shifts.
The market was changing. Where I was spending a full month working on 4 or 5 artists and records trying to get a hit single on them, all of a sudden I'm working on 4, 5, 6 albums. So I couldn't continue the way things were going at the time.
It was more or less the group, the core group, was becoming more and more fragmented.
Family, and it's tough to break up a family, but I just felt that it was going to head for disaster at some point.
Couldn't help but feel saddened by it. This is Booker T and the MGs, and they were the sound of the music that was coming out of there.
Kept on generating more and more revenue, kept on daring to be different, and kept on defying what they said that couldn't be done.
On us, but we gotta face it.
And Al felt like he should give something back to the community, and that we were trying to do the right thing, that we were concerned with civil rights, and were taking an active role to show that.
The whole evolution of Stax was a parallel to what was happening in the civil rights movement. And then when the civil rights movement evolved, devolved some people into this Black Power movement or wave, Stax underwent a transformation as well.
In terms of advertising, promotion, marketing, and research, we're researching Black because that's where our product is directed, and we are supported Black.
Starting all over again. It's gonna be slow. We both know that we can make it.
When whenever there was a black pause in the city of Memphis, Stax rose to the occasion. Al Bell, Isaac Hayes, they made sure of that. You know, it was Stax wasn't militant, but it was all black. You know, we knew the problems that our people were having.
Now you're talking about you're dissatisfied with the way the government is run. You're complaining about unemployment, equal employment, housing. Only you can do something about it.
Bursting with new life, Stax supported many causes. The Black Knights in Memphis, the Angela Davis Defense Fund, the Rainbow Push Coalition. Its efforts helped drive the black economic renaissance.
It was a very timely moment in history with our politics. What was lagging behind was the business development. We could never produce our music. We could produce it, we couldn't distribute it. We didn't own our own talent.
We were doing, at that time, because of segregation, what every other ethnic group had done in America. We had our own hotels, our own banks, our own insurance companies. We were building our own economic base.
Black pride was more than a slogan. It was a way of doing business. Stax embraced traditional black culture and brought it mainstream.
See that a host all dressed in red.
He's gonna trouble.
I loved the Staple Singers. And I said, as soon as I can get this company to a point where I can do it, I'm going and get the Staple Singers, because I think the Staple Singers can be one of the biggest acts out here.
We felt really close to Al because we knew him before Stax, you see. And my father was like a father to him.
So you hear in the Staples message music that made them among popular culture beyond the church. I mean, they became the Staples became the sound of the streets.
I like my gospel.
Ooh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, sure, prayers haven't been answered, my thing, brother thing. Are you sure your prayers haven't been answered, my thing, sister thing? And don't you ask for the good Lord didn't stop to hear ya. He sees everything you do. Stop now and take an inventory. Come up with a different story, because it sees every move you make, every wiggle of your head and wiggle your eyes.
He wanted to put us out of church. Staple Singers singing the devil's music. And I would letting the people know, you know, I tell them, you know, the devil ain't got no music. All music is God's music. I think Al was just trying to stretch us on out further, you know, because he wanted so much for us. We want everybody to get this kind of message. Take our songs and make your life better. Make the world a better place.
You?
Lives were changed when they heard Mavis Staples. When she would sing, you just, you're another person after you witness her.
Oh, you.
We went in for a session, and Matt came in the studio. He said, Pops, I got one for you. Got one for you.
I showed him that song, and he said, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Matt, you know, he got this rhythm. And he started, if you disrespect everybody that you're running to.
I would do you think ever possible to respect you? If you don't give a heck about the man with the Bible in his hand. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We had hit records. it was like great apples falling off a tree.
Respect yourself. Da, 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 da. Respect yourself.
Al Bear, every time he would go out, he'd come back with something solid.
Stax Records replaced cotton as the biggest industry in Memphis, Tennessee.
The Stax corporate staff mushroomed, gathering executives from Motown, Chi-Town, and beyond. Their interests diversified into more soundtracks and soon, movie production.
Shaft. Hotter than Bond, cooler than Bullet.
Somebody got the bright idea of producing a black film with a black director, a black leading actor, and a black composer. They wanted me to do the music.
Now, Isaac put the music together, and the rest is history. He said, dig the tempo of his walking. He said, I want you to play 16ths on the hi-hat to that tempo. So they rolled the machine over to me, and I got to peep over in the machine and play the hi-hat.
In 1972, Isaac Hayes stood on a mountaintop, winning an Academy Award for his theme from Shaft. His date that night was his grandmother.
I call her Mama because that's the only mother I know. And last night was the highlight of my career, so I felt like she should be there. And this award, which I accepted last night, the first time in the history of the Academy, black musician has been honored receiving an Oscar.
Isaac's position to me was more of a social position than a musical position at Stax. Isaac became something of a symbol that was missing in African American society.
Dino was hanging out with me at the time, and he said, man, listen to the people. They love you, man. Man, you just like a Moses. Yeah, you just like black Moses. I said, whoa, whoa, Dino, don't do that, man. That's sacrilegious. I ain't no Moses, man. Yes, you are, man. You black Moses.
I got Isaac's albums here. The latest, Black Moses, has got a spectacular, look at that.
I think he really saw that it was a necessary thing for people to have an icon like that.
The African-American community in Watts had been scarred by riots in the mid-1960s, leaving 34 dead. In August 1972, Stax organized a benefit festival of peace and music in Los Angeles. It drew more than 100,000 people, a fifth of the city's black population.
Soul music sort of rose to its zenith in terms of what it could do politically, economically, and culturally all at once. And that was at Watt Stax.
I'm the son of a bitch!
I ended up going to Watts when it was just smoking from riots and urban frustration, neglect. We were into that kind of setting with that kind of audacity, that kind of ambition.
Sunset. Wanna be like my daddy's.
Went to rent the stadium. They kind of laughed at us. You're some little record company from out of Memphis, Tennessee. And who do you say these artists are? What's the names?
Respect yourself, yeah. You ought to respect yourself.
Been riots where they burned down just about everything, you know. And Watts Stax brought all these 100,000 people together. That was the largest crowd any of us had ever seen.
This was trying to give something back to the neighborhood. Only cost it a dollar.
Can you write on too? I'm gonna tell you what you gotta do. Drop your wings, feet start kicking. Now you know you're doing the funky chicken. Oh, oh.
We're still now on this curve of trying to carry forth the resurrection and the ascension. And that caused others to realize that they could do the same thing in their various ghetto communities across America.
That is why I challenge you now to stand together, raise your fists together, and engage in our national black litany. Do it with courage and determination. I am somebody.
Somebody.
I am
somebody.
I may be poor.
There were many messages, even mixed messages, running through that very moment. Al and I had our fists extended. We survived the rubbish. Like a sphinx rising from the ashes, we'd come back to life again, and there we were at this awesome moment in history.
Right now, the brothers, all of us have been waiting for, brother Isaac.
I
had preached that our music was a reflection of what goes on in our lives and our lifestyles. And Larry Shaw said, well, then what we need to do is film this and make it real.
There was something new in Hollywood movie premieres as over 2,000 soulful people came together for the opening of What's That? Among those attending were Stax recording star Carla Thompson, Sonny and Cher, recording star Johnny Taylor, superstar Isaac Hayes.
What's Stax was during the grand year of 1972. Then they started going downhill pretty fast because they were spending a great deal more than they were making. And I've always been of the opinion that it was riotous living more than anything else, because they just hemorrhaged money.
We were growing so rapidly that we had taken out the loan that gave it to us, and I think it was amortized over a couple of years or something like that. And in 9 months, we paid that loan off, and it freaked them out. It freaked them out. 9 months, and you've paid it off. And from that point on forward, every time we turned around, we were getting calls from Union Planters National Bank wanting to know if we needed any money. Yes, I
am. Hey, it's Duck. I need a loan. Sign a piece of paper. Didn't have to go into anything. I want to buy a car. But I work for Stax. Okay, it's done.
The bloated era came when it seemed like we wanted to be a Motown. That was bloat in the sense of expansive ideas that didn't seem to stray. Our eye was not on the ball anymore. We were looking up in the stands.
They wanted to buy the Tams basketball team.
When we have successfully finalized all elements, the team will be fully owned and operated in the city of Memphis by the Stax organization.
All day long, people wandered up and down the hall. You wondered, who are those people?
I am the director of the statistical department. The statistical department is a new department which has been established by Stax Recording Company. So statistical department went to work and said, well, look, let's take this record, Don't Tell Your Mama, and analyze it. Notice the difference. I want you to notice the strings. And the bass is the predominant factor. That's getting back to the soul. That's where it's at.
This is Rufus Thomas with a brand new band. Look out for the pool. Slits for a liquor pool. Nobody makes more liquor like Slits.
What you see, is what you get.
I started dealing with comedy, and I thought that we could be tremendously successful in comedy.
Remember the essence of life. We are people of the universe, and life is beautiful. My parents go, that nigga crazy.
Also, into the movie production, we went.
Despite continued success, Stax couldn't get its records into suburban department stores. So in 1972, not long after Motown sold out to MCA, Al Bell struck a unique deal with Clive Davis at CBS Records. Stax remained independent, but gained major label distribution.
CBS dominated every category of music in the entire industry other than black music.
Because of the power of Columbia Records and its branches and everything, that would put us in a position where we could reach the white market. And in the discussions with Clive was explaining to me how he wanted to penetrate deeper into the black market and the black community.
The white majors don't know how to produce that product. So what they do is they go and get a black promotion man and say, well, this will solve the problem. Black promotion man, we sell to the black market. Not true. They don't have black product. You got to get that first.
Al Bell was God. In the rhythm and blues music, you can ask anybody that. He dictated what went on in rhythm and blues in those years.
Clive and Al Bell, they both had a dream, and I think they bought into each other's dream. And in their minds, they knew exactly how they could make it work.
Clive Davis became the most powerful man in the music business. His salary and benefits, $350,000 a year. So it was a bombshell when in May of last year, CBS fired Davis.
The charges against Clive Davis stem out of an investigation conducted by United States grand juries here in Newark and in New York.
But unfortunately, when Clive Davis was taken out of the picture, no one else had that vision of that dream at CBS. So consequently, Al Bell was just out there drifting.
CBS warehoused Stax product and withheld payments. At the same time, Stax's longtime bank, Union Planters, buckled under a national real estate crash. To keep solvent, they hired a new president, Bill Matthews.
One of the first things he did was start looking around for problems, and he started turning them up at a pretty sharp rate. The bank had something like $10 million extended Stax Records.
All of a sudden, this guy, who they had just brought in, he said, Al, I don't want you to think I'm a redneck from Georgia. I looked at him and I said, and I don't want you to think that I'm a nigger from Arkansas. So what are you talking about?
Union Planters stopped lending money to Stax, accusing them of bank fraud, and with no money coming from CBS, the squeeze was on.
You had a bank who wanted to destroy the record company. You had people that just hated that all these blacks were having all this success in Memphis, Tennessee, with all these big, pretty houses and pretty cars.
Isaac Hayes is driving around in a custom-made Cadillac that cost more at the time than many white folks' houses did. Or Carla Thomas, or another artist going to Julius Lewis and purchasing a fur coat. Cash.
I'm unimpressed with the racist aspect of this whole thing. I would say there was at least as much racism manifested on the part of the Stax people, who were always trying to use it as a crutch.
Well, at that point in time, we had no sales and no promotion. So I went to my dear friend, Johnny Baylor. I said, and what I need you to do is take your team and go out and promote the Stax product.
Our stack of cards seemed to come tumbling down when Johnny Baylor was getting on an airplane in Memphis to Birmingham.
They asked him to open one of his suitcases, some reason or other. I don't know what it was. But he did, and there was nothing but cash in there.
That's when the IRS and FBI and everyone else came saying, how does this work? What do we do here?
I had people threatening my life. I'd wake up with toilet tissue in the trees in my yard. All kinds of threats on the phone, being told by a gentleman that was sent to me by Matthews, said, listen, why tell Al, why don't he go down to the Mississippi River Bridge and jump off that bridge and make it easier for everybody? They started taking the actions that would put us out of business.
Very easily conclude, I suppose, at this point that the future for Stax would look dim. But that is not the case. We know the facts. We have not given up, and we will pursue legally whatever is necessary in order to restore Stax and bring it from a corporate point of view back into the possession of its rightful owners.
We used to call Al Bell the hype meister. because no matter how dark the situation, Al Bell has the upside to the story.
He could put you in the palm of his hand, and he did it to me. He did it to everyone. Lord, gonna bless you.
To me, I tried to think about it, but I could not fathom the company going under. It, to me, was like the Bank of England or the Rock of Gibraltar.
Well, they're going to talk over some new deals for the company.
In the days when it was all closing in, and the guy that kept our books and stuff, he went over to get our checks. And he came back and he said, there are no checks. And I'm on the steps of that church with Jim Stewart. And I'm shaking my head, and I said, wow, you know, I had all this planned and stuff. And Jim reached in his pocket and pulled out 200 American dollars and gave it to me. And him ending up with nothing.
All this, it was a snowball effect. I put what money I'd gotten for the sale back into the company. Plus, I pledged my personal assets. But it was not enough. Too little, too late.
I saw Jim be really hurt over this because it hurt his children. When you give away your children's fortune, you hurt for them.
And we started watching the demise of everybody slowly. They'd come on the lot and start pulling cars and foreclosing homes and stuff like that, man, and we knew it was on.
I really didn't realize what was happening until it was too late. I had a change of fortune.
The Lavery white gold diamond bracelet watch with initials IH and emerald.
Sometimes growth and ambition can wreck a company. You know, you push one domino and they all fall.
A lot of people lost their homes. They lost their families. One person committed suicide.
The offices of Stax here are closed. A lot of other problems have also plagued the firm. The latest came yesterday. A judge declared the firm officially bankrupt. But that won't
they caused a 16-count indictment to be brought against me and an officer of the bank, alleging that we had conspired to defraud, I think it was $16 or $18 million.
Harwell was convicted and later on admitted that it was he'd made these dishonest loans to Al Bell to the tune of $10 million or so.
Al, in 14 indictments, freed on all charges. But then you got the blood stains in your clothes.
A lot of people were depending on Stax for a living, you know. All the workers that we lost, and you know, it was just a sad thing, like we was at a funeral or something.
After the close of Stax, and after some time had passed, several years, I would drive back to Memphis, Tennessee, and park across the street from 926 East Macklemore, and look at that vacant lot and see the weeds there, building gone, and I would cry. I would cry, and the tears would run profusely. all that we had worked for and lived for, there was not even a symbol of that in place. It's like someone had tried to wipe all of that off the face of the earth.
Sitting in the morning sun, I'll be sitting when the evening comes.
But all great music has soul. It's just that Stax had more of it than so many others. I hadn't grown up on this music. I saw the Staples some years ago when I first arrived in America, and I just found myself reduced to tears at this incredible music.
I think it's called magic when you out there and you find artists. God sent artists that just become those artists that's just timeless. As a young person going to record stores and seeing all them records across the top, and they all just say Stax, you want to be a part of that train.
Look like nothing's gonna come my way.
That was the thing that Stax did over and over. They were great songs, but they had this emotion to them. I think that's what makes the music that was made in Stax really enduring, is that it's very truthful and it's very direct, and it just really grooved. And as best we could, I mean, we couldn't play as good as, you know, the players that played on those records, but we did our version of that. You know, we used that same technique, and that was our guiding light.
Everything seems to stay the same.
The sound of Stax is almost like a good plate of food. I mean, it sticks to your ribs, it sticks to your soul. Soulsville, USA says it all. I might have made my tracks and made my grounds in the rap world, that the fabric and the basic, you know, necessity of the rap world is groove and rhythm, and Stax just did it off the head.
Just to make this dark my home now.
It never dies. Soul music continuously haunts us through every genre of music that we do. So we're here once again. The question and the answer is, it never really left us.
The wealth of experience is just, it's priceless. It's priceless, and it's mine.
Stax lost everything in bankruptcy. A quarter century later, those same songs were sold for tens of millions of dollars, while Fantasy Records made Stax the single most reissued independent label in the world. In 2006, Concord Records bought and relaunched the label, signing new talent and old Stax stars. But its soul, the music, lives as a permanent part of our culture.
At what point did it become the Stax thing? I don't know that. I thought it always was.
One, two.
Stax was one person teaching another. It was one writer teaching another. There were open doors there all of the time where no matter who you were, you could walk through those doors and realize an opportunity. And that's now glorified in the Stax Music Academy. And I have not stopped feeling good because I realized a part of it is still alive.
In the end, the studio was rebuilt according to original blueprints. And next door, the Stax Academy gives neighborhood kids the same chance the label did in its day.
If we did not have the museum, if that building had not been rebuilt the way it was, if we didn't have a Studio A now, not only would the building have been gone, but a part of us would have died. But that was our resurrection, and still is.
So we now have the Stax Museum of American Soul Music and a Stax Music Academy where we're passing the Stax legacy on to a new generation. And don't you cut that line out of the script.
Surely lose us.
find out more, visit pbs.org.
About you, but I can't take no chance. Got me spinning, baby. Baby, I'm in a trance, 'cause your love.